but the trends we're observing and the technologies and practices emerging around us that are already shaping the future, we can start to picture who will become and where higher ed is headed. This section explores bold future scenarios showing where we might be 10 years from now. Daylan finishes with a few final pencil scratches on the notepad in front of him before setting the pencil down on his desk. "Done," he says to himself as he looks up from his notes, an expression of satisfaction on his face. He wheels his toes underneath him and feels warm sand. Just ahead of him, waves crash into the beach beneath the slowly setting sun. Scanning left and right down the shoreline, he sees miles of no one and nothing but palm trees and tall grass against lush green mountains. Desert paradise. Save for Daylan sitting alone at his simple wood desk with his notepad and pencils. Ding! Daylan taps his ear. "I've analyzed your notes," a disembodied woman's voice says. It's Daylan's instructor, or at least a voice programmed to sound like Daylan's instructor. "Your critical analysis is sound, though I'm concerned some of your evidence may still be lacking. This is good enough for today, but let's make more progress tomorrow." "Thanks, Teach. See you tomorrow," Daylan says as he taps his ear again. He swipes his left hand and a large screen appears in front of him, hovering just above the sand. He calls up Season 2, Episode 5 of his favorite show, a zero-gravity space cooking competition. The screen blinks on and the show intro starts to play against the sound of the waves. Ding! Daylan taps his ear. "You've reached your 5-hour limit, powering down to ensure optimal physical and mental conditioning," a man's voice with a proper English accent instructs. Bit by bit, the ocean waves and sky and sand and TV screen all begin to blur and pixelate. Daylan's vision goes dark. He removes the visor from his head and looks at the dorm room around him, blinking to get his eyes to focus. Sirens blare from somewhere down the street. Rain pounds against the window, unrelenting for the third straight day that week. Daylan's roommate is asleep on his bunk, visor still on his head, faintly playing sounds of something like a carnival or theme park. Daylan sets his visor on its charging dock. 5% charged, it reads. Daylan sighs. The growth. We see a shift away from face-to-face environments toward virtual ones as AI and virtual reality technologies grow unfettered during a period of ongoing polycrises. Toast Sanders slams his fist down on the provost's desk. His daughter, Sarah, flinches and then rolls her eyes. "You're going to sit there and tell me my daughter is going to be the first Sanders in 4 generations not to attend this school, all because of..." He gestures at the provost's tablet on the desk. "Some algorithm?" "Mr. Sanders," the provost says as she leans forward in her chair and taps the screen on her tablet. The screen jumps to life, displaying a dashboard of dials and charts. She considers the display for a moment and then looks back up at Tove and Sarah. "I hear your frustration and I sympathize with you and sincerely appreciate your family's loyalty to our institution these past many decades. But you need to understand the decision we're having to make. Your daughter's record..." The provost stops herself and shifts her attention to Sarah. "Sarah, your record simply doesn't allow us to admit you as a student at the school." The provost turns her tablet around to face the Sanders. A voice from the tablet begins to narrate, highlighting dials and charts as it talks. "Looking at your academic history, our analysis of your digital footprint and your federal socioeconomic markers, you score in the lowest quartile of student likelihood to complete your education," the voice concludes. The provost interjects, gesturing at the American flag in the corner of the office. "And as you know, if we don't admit students with the highest likelihood of completion, we risk losing our good standing and even our funding." Sarah blushes, embarrassed, but persists. "I know what kind of student I used to be, and I know some of the dumb choices I've made, but if you look at the last 12 months of my digital footprint data, you'll see that I'm not that person anymore. I've turned my academics around, I've stabilized my personal spending, and I've cleaned up my digital profile." The provost sighs. "Be that as it may, 12 months simply isn't enough time to correct 12 years of data. Keep doing what you're doing, keep improving, and maybe in a few years we'll start to see your score improve, and you can revisit our options for ensuring the Sanders legacy stays here with us." She glances at Tove with a wink, and smiles at Sarah. Now, she says, why don't we walk over to the dining hall and get you both some coffee or a pastry? It's the least I could do. In the constraint scenario, institutional operations are limited by government regulations that mandate the use of analytics for decision making. Dr. Bhatti opens the virtual meeting room and students trickle in. Some students have their cameras turned off and their mics muted. Others are on screen seated against the backdrop of their bedroom or virtual tropical or wooded landscape. Good to see everyone, or at least to see the ones I can see, says Dr. Bhatti. Last session, we were continuing our discussion on NASA's Apollo program and the social and cultural impacts of that program on our nation's history. I want to revisit something that came up near the end of our session we didn't really have time to resolve. Dr. Bhatti switches to screen share mode and displays a grainy black and white photo depicting astronaut Neil Armstrong walking across a lunar surface. The Apollo lunar module in the background behind him. On the upper left edge of the photo, just in view, the faint outline of a television studio lighting rig can be seen. On the bottom left edge of the photo, the silhouette of a camera crew who'd wandered just into view of the camera. As we were studying these archival photos of the moon landing hoax, Dr. Bhatti continues, Sam brought up the question of the authenticity of these photos, which, as we know, were only recently declassified and made public by the United States government. Specifically, Sam seems to be suggesting that this photo could have been AI-generated, with the implication that perhaps the moon landing wasn't a hoax after all. The virtual chat window lights up with comments and GIFs and links. One student comments, "Sheeple will believe anything," with a laughing emoji. Another student shares a link to an article with the title, "Seven Biggest Lies of History and Why We Fell for Them." Sam adds their own comment in the chat. So we're just going to pretend 70 years of space exploration never happened? Dr. Bhatti pulls down his screen share and his face comes back into full view. He glances at the chat window and grins. Of course, Sam. We know that not all space exploration has been a lie, especially the more recent privately funded exploration. I think the bigger point we're trying to stress here, if I can bring us back to the focus of the session, is that in the mid-20th century, we started to see a concerted effort by those in the government and positions of power to obscure truth and create new versions of facts that serve their own purposes. Dr. Bhatti pastes a link into the Zoom chat, a video titled, Why Space in the 1960s Was So Believable. A friend of mine shared this video with me, he explains. Some interesting ideas in here about the role of the media and entertainment industries in fostering untruths. I recommend checking it out, but only after class, of course. The potential future for collapse sees rapid and unregulated generated AI proliferation, leading to a collapse of truth. For immediate release, Swanson Industries, March 25th, 2035. Leading security solution provider, Swanson Industries announces a national search for its 2035 class of management trainees. This is an exciting opportunity for recent college-prepared and college-certified individuals to gain valuable experience in work environment that is results-oriented, challenging, and rewarding. Up to 6 applicants will be selected as this year's trainees and will serve a 12-month term in their designated area of functional potential. Training will focus on getting hands-on experience, acquiring new requisite skills, and building on existing proficiencies that will help them land their first big job and launch them on their professional journey. Trainees may also receive priority consideration for long-term employment at Swanson as opportunities become available. Applicants must have accumulated a minimum of 200 college work points in order to be eligible, and strong preference will be given to applicants with work preparation scores demonstrating satisfactory skills attainment in their designated area of functional potential. Proof of certifications may be required depending on the applicant's designated function, though completion of full college cycle is not required regardless of function. each college affiliated with our 6 successful applicants will receive a one-time investment of $50,000 to help fund their skills programming and will receive a special training partner designation with privileges for the 12-month duration of the management trainee program. See terms and conditions for training partner privileges. Swanson is dedicated to keeping our jobs and industries in the United States, and applicants must be fully certified U.S. citizens in good standing and must be willing to agree to Swanson's commitment to U.S. industry standards. To apply, submit the application form linked below, along with the requested supporting documentation no later than May 25, 2035. Applicants will be notified of a decision no later than June 12, 2035. Finally, in the transformation scenario, a period of political instability leads to a series of revolutionary changes in higher education, where industry and workforce needs to drive enrollments and curriculum.